mean, only then speculation might help. If we haven't got the open space, and we haven't got any of the detail in front of us, then says it hairs when it is not. That's the advice. That's the advice I get. Well, I think what I wanted to just understand was that we're moving from a 10%, 20% broad brush to something different. And the advice that we've had, or the presentation we've had, is that this is going to be born out of a viability assessment study that is underway. And it's not going to be helpful to second guess what may or may not be in that study. The 40% figure that any referred to is 2,000 diamonds. That was the whole bore. That was the last assessment that we had. What year was that? 2006. So it's a good, however many years ago, where they said across the board you should be looking at 40%. And we didn't adopt that as a standard. We adopted a 10%, 20% split. So what we end up adopting will depend upon the evidence. And I'm not sure we can usefully debate percentages. Well, we don't know the percentages are being recommended, and we don't know the evidence that's behind it.
Accept that if the 40% is setting itself to make the number one finger. Fair enough. But nevertheless, the criteria for it to be on site is very important to development and viability. And I'll go back to the central point of what I want to see, and I'm sure all members want to see, is the revitalisation and the regeneration of Birkenhead. And that the plan should focus around a 15-year plan to do that. West Wirral has to take some hit in that, fair enough. We're all part of Wirral. However, I don't think that skewing it towards West Wirral will help achieve Birkenhead achievement. Especially if it's on something
like that. So, you didn't say that at all. And the last paragraph specifically addresses off-site provision or equivalent payments in them. So it says there's a process for securing off-site provision. Maybe that's a paragraph that we wanted to raise separately because we've had other discussions about it. But it doesn't say it's got to be on site. There seems to me to be a mechanism there for off site as well. Ian?
Thanks. I think in terms of the viability, I think the important thing is that the developer will surely have to publish the viability assessments. So that will deal with any aspect that we think when proposal is viable or not, it will be in black and white and not in public. So it won't be for us to second guess the developer anymore. It'll be black and white whether the developer thinks 40% affordability or 20% affordability or whatever it is viable. And we'll have to be and they'll have to evidence that one. So it takes the responsibility away from us to do that to down to the developer in public.
That's right. I think that's probably a debate we'll have to have when we get that report and go back to affordability to see what it is that we want and we want. I was just going to say, you've reminded me that the last planning committee, there was a report for Geoffrey, I think flats in Geoffrey,
yeah.
And there weren't any affordable housing and the developer cited viability. I'd asked the question why it wasn't published. And it turns out the application was submitted prior to the government changing the rules to make it. That's why it wasn't there. So it wasn't a slip up, strictly speaking, about the plan about it. But so in the future we will have those, and that will concentrate, hopefully, minds in that direction.
I don't think we have a problem in Foulkes House being exposed to 300,000 pounds, all Foulkes communities. I know we haven't got the empty space in front of me, but just curious about what's driving the viability issues in Zone 1. Is it because of land conditions or land values?
It's market evidence that the consultants are looking at. As you said, the value of the land compared with what we can get out of the office and the
building credit, I'm not going to refer to any specific kind of application or opinion, but I think we need to be clear that we're expecting a decent